glad you guys are here today. Oh, is that on? Check. Make sure I turned it on. Oh, that's why. That won't work. Check, check, check. Hey, battery cells. Welcome. Hey, glad you guys are here today. If you have never been to the conference before, we always begin this section the same way because it's very, very important to us. We pray for another church in town. Today, we're actually going to do a little extra praying at the end, but right now I want to pray for a local body of believers over at Victorious Life Christian Center. We are passionate that we are in the same body of Christ with all those that believe the same things in common. In fact, that's why we're called the common, so we share in common with the greater church and all of its beautiful diversity around the world. But Tim Masters is my good friend. His wife Jewel are the pastors over at Victorious Life. They meet at Flagstaff Middle School. It used to be there. So if you're the praying type, join me, and we'll pray for them in our time together as well. God, thanks for today, and God, thank you for Tim and Jewel, and thank you for, God, just their church, about the same age as ours, the last 3 or 4 years that has started in this town. I pray that you bless them, God. I pray that as they grow, they will always grow closer to you, and we will grow closer to them. I pray that they're really experiencing your love and sharing your love in the best of ways, God. And hopefully, Lord, all of us that have found your great love, we'll together share that story with this town and with the world. God, we love them. We also pray today as we open your word that you will open our eyes and our ears to see what you might have for us. We thank you for the freedom that we have to be in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm sure many of you, the first thing you noticed today was that it looks like a hipster vomited on our stage, all these lights. I think they're pretty cool, these little hipster light bulb things. I don't even know where Kyle got them, but they're pretty. It looks like stars in the sky or lightning bugs or a lamp store. It looks like one of those things. And I feel like that will usher you into the presence of God today. So I hope that blesses you as much as it has me. I hope you had a really great week. It's been really crazy. I don't know how many of you are parents or involved with school. Some of you are teachers I know at school. But school started this week, which to me seems to be some sort of cosmic failure in the universe that somehow we would start school for children at the beginning of August. But that happened. And so that's been kind of crazy for me because I have become full-time Mr. Mom, driving kids back and forth to school all day. But at the same time, it hasn't transitioned out of summer yet because we still have soccer practices for 3 of my 4 kids. And Colt has started football. And that's been a pretty cool adventure for me. Colt is 7 years old, and so he joined this Flagstaff Eagles football team. And it's brand new to him. And this last week, they had practices every single night from 5 to 7 in their full pads. And it was pretty cool, like, sitting over there and watching him because he's going through things at 7 years old that I went through at 12 years old. I became a huge American football fan. I played all through high school and in college, and I loved the sport. But at 12 years old, I realized that it really, really hurts to get hit in football, which is kind of a shocker when you grow up really excited to play football. And I'm watching Colt out there, and he's getting hit. He's having to get used to it, adjust, toughen up. It's pretty cute, and I'm pretty proud of him. But it's also cool because his coaches remind me so much of the football days that I haven't been a part of in so long. Because even though we're in Flagstaff, Arizona, I'm telling you, these guys sound like Texans. They have like rural accents and they just yell at them the whole time. They're like, you get up here and you get blah, blah, blah. You know, and I'm just like, wow, that's like my childhood. It's cool that Colt's going to experience that. And I was reflecting. I was thinking, when was the last time I was yelled at? You know, it's something that kind of you leave later in life. I don't know who you work for if you're an adult. I don't know if your bosses yell at you in that way. But by the way, his coaches are great. They're just encouraging. But it's just like that football environment. You know, they're all fired up. And it was reminding me of how I could use today to tell some war stories from my days in athletics just so you will think highly of me. And that's what I'm going to do because I have a microphone and I have the power. So here's the deal. I grew up at this place called Boys Ranch. And at Boys Ranch, it was a juvenile delinquent facility, and my parents worked there. And when I grew up there, sports was the whole world. Everything was sports. But one of the unique kind of things that happened at Boys Ranch is we kind of got all of the local town's terrible coaches who got fired at other schools because parents complained would come to Boys Ranch because there was no parents. And so this is like a perfect thing for them. So Boys Ranch was filled with coaches. By the way, my dad was one of them. But he was pretty balanced, I would think. That got fired in their places because they were so crazy. I had this one coach. His name was Paul Bell. Okay, we called him the big dog because he was this giant guy. I think he weighed 300 pounds. He was probably 6'6". And all he wore was like triple extra large. Remember those big dog t-shirts they used to have? Like dogs playing poker. You know, I mean, that's all he wore was big dog stuff. Because I guess he thought that he was the big dog. But anyway, he loved to yell. In fact, It was so bad. I played basketball with him. He was my JV coach, and he actually took my dad's place. My dad became athletic director, and then he was my varsity coach. I was really bummed. I didn't get to play for my dad. But it was really cool. It was because when we traveled to other towns felt so sorry for us. I'm not lying. They would sometimes start to cheer for us because they were so embarrassed for what we were going through. Paul Bell would get down in your face, and I'm not kidding you, he would get 1 inch away from your face and scream at the top of his lungs. I remember I couldn't understand a word he was saying whenever I was in trouble, and I just took the slobber. It was just slobbering all over my face. And that's not an exaggeration. Literally, you just knew you had to take it, because if you twitched or complained about the spit, you were going to get it even worse. Let me give you a little bit more of a lens of who he was. So one of the things he liked to do, he would take us into the natatorium, our indoor swimming pool area, because it was really hot in there. It had these big cement steps. And so instead of practicing basketball, this is varsity high school basketball, by the way, he decided that most practices, we would just run the whole time. 3.5 hours, it didn't matter, the whole time we would run. And by the way, again, varsity high school basketball, every single day we wore a full weight vest, had to zip it up so we had an extra 30 pounds on. And we had to wear ankle weights, so we had an extra 10 pound on each ankle. And we had to wear dribble glasses, like we were at a 12-year-old summer camp learning how to dribble. And we never didn't do that. And the best part was we played with a medicine ball all the time. Just so you know, we were the worst shooting team in the history of high school basketball. But his philosophy was, he doesn't care, we can outrun him. We're gonna just run him to death. And I mean, it was amazing. We had one of the worst seasons in recorded high school history. I'm not sure if we won maybe 2 games. But we lost every game like 125 to 123. Because we would just run up and down with everybody. We just couldn't play any basketball. But one particular day, we were running in there. We're getting hot and sweaty. That's all he wanted us, to just be miserable. And we're running around. And then we had to hop up on one leg, up and down the cement block steps. They're all about 2.5 feet block steps, and the other leg. And I slipped one day, and I hit my shin. Actually, still, I don't know if you can see that. There's a scar right there. I think you can, because I can see it. Look at that. I can even feel it. There's a dent right there. I slipped, and I hit my shin on the corner of that concrete. And immediately, it started squirting blood out, like an artery. You guys like that, don't you? Yeah, that's why you come to church. And so, hey, coach, you know, he's like, look at this. And he said his famous line, he said, is it pain or injury? And I was like, there's blood squirting out of my leg. I don't know if you noticed that. He said, is it pain or injury? And what that means is, if you're injured, you're done. You're not going to be starting anymore. You're like the injured sissy. We weren't allowed to be injured. I'm not kidding you, he made me finish practice without stopping the bleeding. So I had to continue practicing for another hour and a half. By the time I was done, you're gonna love this. My sock was soaked red, my leather shoe had swollen with blood. My shoe looked like it was overweight, it was fat, because the leather actually swelled up with the bleeding. I had to get new shoes, because he literally wouldn't even let me stop the bleeding. Here's the other things this guy's doing. We would play games, sort of weight games, and he's so big on conditioning. The first thing we do, we always had to wear a suit. We show up at a local town, we get out, we go to the locker room, we change, we go out, you know, like Eye of the Tigers playing or something, you're supposed to do layups. Not us. We ran suicides or ladders the whole time to warm up for the game. And, you know, this is a small town Texas basketball. You know, there's 5,000 people at the town there all to come watch. Like, are those guys running laps to like get started? Yeah. Guess what we did at halftime? We didn't go in and talk about our strategy. We ran laps in front of the crowd the whole time. I was a point guard. Guess what I did during free throws? In front of 5,000 people in these little gyms, I would run ladders during free throws. He was that crazy. Guess what we did after the game was over, win or loss? We ran more ladders because he wanted everybody to know how in shape we were. Then we would drive back 2.5 hours, get home at 2 a.m. Guess what we knew when we got home at 2 a.m? We would run in the gym for another hour, even if we won. The guy was crazy. It was insane. Now, do you guys all think that I'm really tough now? No. That's all I want to know, so we shut it down. All right, that's valid. Here's what I was thinking about. As I think about Coach Paul Bell and his strategy, and by the way, he wasn't all that bad. I'm telling all the horror stories. I mean, he's pretty bad, but there were some good redeeming things about him. He's a complex person. And then I thought about all the different coaches I had, and then I watched my own kids. I watched their soccer coaches and their football coaches, and they all have a different communication style, right? You know, some kids actually really respond well to that. In fact, I liked it. I didn't mind Coach Bell. It didn't bother me. He was telling me the truth. I didn't care if he was slobbering it across my face. But, oh, you know, I didn't need to get better at that. Some kids don't respond well to that, but we communicate in different ways. And when I think about Coach Bell, the big dog, I used to think of him as a bear or some sort of image to sum up what kind of person he was. There's all sorts of different people we encounter, and that is exactly what we're doing in our new discussion that we started last week. Let me explain. If you weren't here last week, we began a new discussion where we're taking a very, very close look at the four gifts that we have. I mean, these are textual, historical gifts of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And last week, we looked very closely and specifically at the book of Matthew, who Matthew was, his style, his image. But when I think about Paul Bell and his idea that he was this bear, this roaring lion, that's kind of what the early church fathers and 2,000 years of church history has given us about the gospel authors. In fact, there's this thing called the Book of Kells in Ireland. I was there last summer. You open it up. It's got all these beautiful illustrated things. I have the picture of this. I tried to show you last week. Let me see if it's here. This is a picture from the Book of Kells. This is about a 1,200-year-old Bible. It has a bunch of different stuff. But the monks, they were artists, and they would draw these four different pictures to represent the four Gospels that we have contained in the Bible. This is a human face, as you can tell, and this is Matthew. And even though this is only 1,200 years old, this goes back to the very first century. In the very first century, the early church started to say, hey, how can we understand who Matthew was? How can we get our mind wrapped around the way Mark communicated, and Luke, and John? So throughout time, this is called iconography. It's taking icons and pictures to help us frame the different things that have been given to us. So Matthew always has this human face. This right here, what is that animal? Yeah, that's right, a lion. None of you said that, right? It looks like an eagle. This is a lion, but even though you can't tell because it has wings and it looks like a bird, that's clearly a lion. And that's Mark, because Mark is always a lion. And all throughout Kells, this is an ox, which represents Luke, and this is an eagle, which represents John. And the reason I wanted to bring this up is because for our discussion, I want to use these icons or these images to help us get that same framework. Why would we do that? What's the point? Well, I think it enriches and helps us to understand a couple of things. One, how unique each gospel is. Last week, the illustration I used is kind of like the portraits of Winston Churchill that are very different, but kind of give you different aspects of understanding who he was historically. And the same is true if I were going to tell you about my daughter Aspen. I could give you one picture of a bunch of spaghetti on her face as a child, and you would think, I know everything I need to know about that child. She can't eat. She's disgusting. Or I could give you a picture from her soccer match, and you'd think, oh, she must be terrible at school or good at sports or whatever. But if you had four pictures, you would have a little bit more information. And here's the thing. The Gospels are better than pictures. And one of the things we talked about last week, this is very important for understanding them, is what sort of thing is a gospel? Gospel is just this old English word, contracted gospel, which means good news, which comes from the very earliest church fathers who wrote the good news of Mark. This is a great message to be put out there. Well, what sort of thing is it? Is it a historical biography? Is it mythology? What kind of elements do we find? And what we talked about last week, and you can go view the message if you want, is they fit very nicely into this thing that we don't know about in modern categories called Greco-Roman lives. Okay, very common in Greece and Rome. People wanted to write about great philosophers and great teachers and maybe even great miracle or wonder workers, and they would do that in a certain format. They would write it on a parchment that was about 10 meters long and would have 10 to 20,000 words, and it would all just be straight Greek letters in that time. And it would tell the story, and usually it kind of jumped right to the adult life, maybe a little bit of a birth narrative to give you a background, and then you would hear the story of this person, usually culminating in their death. And guess what? It's exactly what the Gospels are. They were written around the Mediterranean in that culture, in that genre, and Mark is one of those. Here's a bigger picture of Mark as the lion, just if you want to see it. This is up close because you can't see it. The lion represents Mark, and here's why. There's a couple reasons. One, Mark himself is a bit like the lion. In fact, people disagree about why this icon has represented the gospel for a long time. But I want you to hear and lean in closely because I'm hoping it will in some way enrich. If you take the challenge to read through Mark, the shortest of the Gospels this week, you'll look through the lens of understanding the church has always seen this as the gospel of the lion. Now, we're tempted probably to put our own imagery of what a lion means. And it's typical in modern times we would think of a lion as representing kingship or something like that. But interestingly enough, in the first century, that's not the case. In fact, all of the Jewish scriptures, all of the Old Testament, teach us that the lion represents enemies. David used it often in the Psalms, that the lions are prowling around. Even Peter in the New Testament describes Satan in such a way. He's a lion roaring, trying to roar around and find things. So it's kind of conflicting to say, what does it mean that Mark was the lion? Here's what I want to do. Very quickly, before we get to the good stuff, give you a little bit of an overview of what Mark is like. There's a lot of cool stuff we know about the Gospel of Mark right away. First of all, who was Mark? Well, John Mark is what scholars agree is the person who wrote Mark. We call him Mark the Evangelist or Saint Mark. And we know quite a lot about him for certain. And then we know quite a lot from early church tradition. It's pretty interesting. He was supposed to be, and most scholars agree, that he founded the Church of Alexandria in Egypt. In fact, most people believe he was born in northern Egypt, probably the one that brought the gospel to Africa. As it exploded around the Mediterranean, John Mark took it to Egypt and founded what we call the Coptic Orthodox Church, very strong still to this day in Egypt. In fact, I have a very dear friend that's a classmate of mine at St. Andrews, who's an Egyptian Coptic Orthodox priest, and he is steeped in tradition. I mean, he values deeply that their roots go all the way back to this disciple of Jesus. Now, he wasn't one of the 12. I don't know if any of you are under that misconception, but if you go read the lists of the disciples, John Mark was not one of the 12 apostles. But what we know from the Coptic tradition, from the early church, is that he was supposedly, I wouldn't go to my death over this, but the only evidence we have of who he was, is he was one of the guys. John tells the story of Jesus turning water to wine in John chapter 2. He was supposedly one of those guys who had come from Africa and was hired, that was in Cana at the wedding, and he poured the wine, that water that had turned into wine, and that opened him up to following Jesus. And then the tradition says he became one of the 70 disciples of Jesus, that Jesus sends out the 70 outside of the 12. And then it says that they come back, the stories tell us, all the synoptic gospels, these 70 disciples come back, and Jesus starts giving them some really harsh teachings about communion and eating my flesh and drinking my blood. And it says most of those disciples left him at that time, and tradition tells us John Mark was one that left him. He had followed Jesus from that very beginning, that first miracle at Canaan, and then after all this unfolded, he said, I couldn't take it anymore, and he abandoned him. But somewhere between that abandonment and the explosion of the early church, he came back to faith in Christ. Maybe he heard stories of the resurrection, but his main role, this is the main part you need to hear, is he got connected with Peter as Peter started to travel around as the head of the church, the rock. And as it was really going big, John Mark became his interpreter. Remember, he grew up around Alexandria. He probably spoke Coptic. We know he spoke Aramaic, which I'll talk to you in a minute about. And he wrote his gospel in Greek. Now, here's the thing about Mark. He lived an extraordinary life. He followed Peter. He translated him. Most of Mark, most scholars believe, is him recounting the teachings of Peter as Peter traveled around. So it's much very valuable in that way, in that sense. And then here's the cool thing. He went on to become the first bishop of Alexandria. He brought the message of Christianity to Africa. And his life, like so many others back then, and by the way, so many others today, ended in martyrdom. Because the people of Alexandria were really frustrated in the same way that they still are in Egypt, the conflict of religions, that Christianity had a unique claim. And so in 68 AD, they drug a rope around John Mark's neck and they dragged him around the city until he was dead. That's important. Because John Mark's gospel, this is what I really want you to hear, is dark. It's not filled with great hope and promises like a lot of the others. In fact, John Mark's gospel is filled with mystery more than anything else. The divine secret, a lot of people refer to Mark. It's the shortest of the gospels. It's the earliest gospels. The earliest traditions say he wrote it in 43 AD, probably around 13 years after Christ's resurrection. He's writing down for the very first, before any other evangelist, the stories of Jesus. It's only 16 chapters long and barely chapter 16. Here's what I want to do before we dive into some of the contents. I want to give you an analogy of how it unfolds. It's a little bit like a symphony, and it's a little bit weird. It does fit the genre for sure of a Greco-Roman lives narrative, because often they just jump right into the story. That's exactly what happens in Mark 1. We're told at the beginning, hey, this is the story of Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. All of a sudden, John the Baptist is announcing him. He's being baptized. And boom, like drinking from a fire hydrant, we are full force story after story after story. Now, it's a lot like a symphony in this way. There's one symphony in particular. I'm actually going to play a minute of it for you here, which is going to be awesome. Now, who wanted to hear some classical music today? Yeah, nerds. This is actually a piece of one of my favorite composers. This is Aaron Copland. Wait, don't start it yet. This is Aaron Copland. He's my favorite American composer for sure. He wrote a symphony called Rodeo, and this is a piece that you've heard before, this movement four of a symphony called Hoedown. I want you to listen, and as you listen, I want you to notice how it starts at an insanely fast pace, and then it kind of slows down to this loping pace, and then it kind of gets to its driving melody. So go ahead, Kyle, play it loud. Crank it up. Part. beef. That makes me angry. It's one of the greatest American things ever composed, and then they made it a beef commercial. That's all we can think about. My whole point today is to recapture that from beef to the Gospel of Mark. If I've done that, I have succeeded in life. So you'll never think about that beef commercial again. Here's how it does fit Mark, though. That's exactly what Mark does. The beginning of Hoedown is just like that. It comes in at this fast pace. It's kind of all over the board. It's random. It slows down in the middle, and then you get this really classic instrumental stick-in-your-mind movement towards the end. It's really a very pretty piece. That's only a microcosm of the whole symphony, obviously. But that's what Mark is like. It starts out crazy. In the first couple of chapters, there's already four or five miracles. He's already rounded up the disciples that are on their way. Interestingly, in chapter 2, Levi, who is Matthew, gets called to be a disciple, which remember last week, Matthew doesn't even tell his own story. It's Mark who tells us how Matthew became a disciple. There's this beautiful story, and right now I'm just vomiting this stuff on you because I want to get to the main point. There's a beautiful story in chapter 2 of the paralytic, and the reason it's so important is because these four guys drag the guy, the paralytic, on a mat. You remember the story? They rip through the roof. Jesus is talking. Dirt's coming down. They lower him down. And all of a sudden, he says, your sins are forgiven. Right? This is shocking. Oh, this is chapter 2 of Mark. He's already just vomiting on you how this incredible teacher is. And all of a sudden, the Pharisees there, there's enemies, there's conflict all throughout Mark. And they're saying, how can he forgive sins? Only God alone can forgive sins. And then Mark narrates, tells us that as God, he knew their thoughts, and he said, which is easier to say, I forgive your sins, or get up and walk? But so that you know that I have the authority to forgive sins, i.e., so that it's very clear at the beginning of Mark, the earliest gospel, that I am God, get up and walk. He gets up, and he walks, and everyone has to go, who is this guy? Nobody says they can forgive sins. And nobody surely backs it up by healing a paralytic who walks out of the room. And we're introduced to Mark's literary style. The question of who Jesus is a haunting secret over the whole gospel. In fact, there's two words that we've derived very specifically in English from Mark's gospel. One of them is the divine secret, and there's this Greek word, mysterion, and that is a derivative directly into English of mystery. He uses that word often because people keep trying to figure out who Jesus is. He claims to be the Son of Man. The narrator in Mark says he's the Son of God. The voice from heaven at the baptism says, this is my Son, who I'm well pleased. The demons come out and say, we know you're the Holy One of God. All the supernatural cosmic elements of Mark are crying out that this is God in a human body. But Jesus keeps going, shh, 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 shh. That's the secret. I'm the Son of Man. I'm fully human. In the same way that Matthew, the human face, taught us the Jewish human side of Jesus, Mark, the earliest gospel, knew centrally in the cosmic understanding that this was God in a body. So for 8 chapters, there's that word mystery, and then there's this other one for the first 8 chapters. There's this word called dynamo in the Greek. It looks like a U, but we've transliterated it into the word dynamic or dynamite. And that's the word for miracle or wonder, because for 8 chapters, he's flying all over Galilee, as far north as Caesarea Philippi, to Nazareth. He's cruising. It's almost like Mark has no care of time or space or anything. It's like this lion, because this is where Jesus becomes the lion, is pouncing around. And he's powerful, and he's enigmatic, and he's mysterious. And he has a lot of conflict. In fact, Mark and Mark alone tells us that Jesus' family was so embarrassed with him, they confronted him. And Matthew and Luke were so uncomfortable having access to Mark's gospel that they watered down that a little bit. They didn't even want to talk about how passionately his family was against him. Everybody was Jesus' enemy except for one group of people, the disciples. That's where we're going to go to the Bible. This is an interesting thing that I want you to hear about Mark. As you think about it as a symphony and the fast pace at the beginning, there is a very, very clear halftime. There's a clear turning point in Mark chapter 8 in which the whole gospel hinges. And you have to remember this is Peter's stories. You know, John Mark is telling us his version of the teachings of Jesus through Peter, who he followed around and interpreted. And Peter is the hinge point. This is Mark chapter 8. This is what's going on. This is verse 27. It says, Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked them, who do people say that I am? They replied, well, some say John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked? Who do you say that I am? Peter answered, you are the Messiah. And Jesus warned them not to tell anyone. Shh. By the way, you there is plural. It says, who do you guys say that I am? And Peter stands up and represents them all and says, well, we know that you are the Messiah. And so Mark has introduced this really enigmatic, powerful Messiah. For 8 chapters, we've been bouncing around with this lion, and you can't help but make analogies to C.S. Lewis books and Aslan the lion, because it's very much what Jesus is like in Mark. In fact, literarily, if you're interested in this kind of thing at all, he's terrible at Greek. In fact, Mark has been criticized for his Greek for years. It wasn't his native language. He had to write and communicate to a Greek and Roman world. And he uses the present tense often when he's telling a past tense story. It's almost as if, have you ever been around an elderly friend or a grandpa that speaks and says, well, back then this happened, and she says to him, and I says to him, they use the present tense talking about the past. And it's colloquial, and it's charming, and it almost wraps you into the story in some way. Well, 151 times in Mark uses the present tense for a past tense situation. And he always uses the same phrase over and over again. More than the whole Bible combined, Mark uses the word immediately or straight away. It's stressful. For 8 chapters, everything's straight away and immediate. This is what's next. And it's all of a sudden like Jesus is this maniac lion jumping around in power, and nobody knows what to do with him until chapter 8. And all of a sudden, the symphony changes. Because the disciples, who are very complex in Mark, they get it. They've translated the chaos, and they say, oh, you're God's own hand working salvation. You're the Messiah. You're the chosen one. Right after that, Jesus gets angry. It's a very bizarre story. He says, he then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders. It's the theme for Mark. He wants to transition the whole gospel to the suffering of Jesus. Because see, they have a picture as Jewish people. They know what the Messiah is supposed to be. But what they don't know is that this lion is going to die. So immediately at the hinge point, when Peter recognizes who Jesus is, he says, ah, now let me tell you what a real Messiah does. And he dies. He suffers at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, that he must be killed after 3 days and rise again. He spoke plainly about this, which contrasts the mystery of the first 8 chapters. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Great idea, rebuke a lion. When Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You don't have in mind the things of God, but the human concerns, but merely human concerns. Is this not one of the weirdest things the loving Jesus has ever said? To call someone else Satan? Now, there's a lot we need to think about here. We have a preconception. We've survived the Middle Ages and Dante's Inferno, and we've got the Satan, the pitchfork. But we got to remember the Hebrew word Satan means the accuser. He's saying the accusation needs to get behind me. You know, Mark only shares with us 2 sentences about the temptation in the desert, but the other synoptic gospels tell us of this epic battle, this cosmic battle where Satan and Jesus confront each other. And it's all about the identity of who Jesus is. If you're really the Son of God, do this. You can take the easy route. You can take the power route. That's what the temptation of Jesus was all about. And all of a sudden, when Peter's rebuking him, saying, you don't have to suffer, you don't have to die, there's a better way, he said, I recognize this voice. This is not Peter's voice. This is the voice of the accuser. This is the one that wants me to be a conquering Messiah instead of a suffering Messiah. So Jesus, as a lion, rebukes Peter back and obviously loves him. They continue to grow in their relationship. And then it goes through this slow section where we start to see the enemies develop, and then we get to the classic chorus of March. In Hoedown, there's that just recognizable, beautiful piece of the symphony. Often commentators throughout 2,000 years have said that Mark is basically just a passion narrative with a really long introduction. And basically what we get to is starting in chapter 11 through 16, we get the most detailed account of the passion in the Gospels. And all of a sudden this author, who's been all over the place and doesn't care about time and space, dials it in with days of the week in specific location and takes us through the last week of the life of Jesus. He has all sorts of literary genius tools. Even though he wrote poor Greek, you can hear his, as a textual critic, you can see his Aramaic or Semitic mind as he's conjunctioning phrase after phrase, and he's sandwiching ideas together in actually a very intellectual way. We see that Jesus overturns the temple, and he rides in as a conquering king on a colt that's never been ridden, just like any first century king would do. And all of a sudden we find out that everything he's predicted 3 times over, from the time Peter confessed, 3 times Jesus, with more and more detail, tells that he will die as a suffering king. We get to the story of the cross. Now, I'm going to go there for a second, and you guys that have been here on Easter know that I always hit on this a little bit. I love Mark's version. He's obsessed with threes. Everything comes in sets of threes. Even chapter 13. Chapter 13, a lot of scholars believe, is the only thing that Mark pulled from another source and put into his own words. because it's very, they call it the Mark and Apocalypse. It's when he talks about the future destruction of Jerusalem, escalating all the way to the future eschaton or end of all things when God makes all things right. But even there, he takes whatever source he had and he puts it in his language of threes. And Jesus only says three things on the cross. And it comes down to this beautiful one in Mark chapter 15 after everyone's shocked. And by the way, the disciples have been awful. They haven't understood anything since chapter 8. Jesus is getting more and more frustrated with the disciples and their lack of understanding anything. The gospel gets darker and darker and darker until we have this on the cross. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. At 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani." That's actually Aramaic. It's a rare time where a gospel writer writes in his native tongue and he translates for us, my God, why have you forsaken me?" As you know, I'm passionate to point out that there obviously is some sort of element of God experiencing rejection this time, but not in the sense of God turning his face away because he can't look at sin. That's a myth that came late into the church, because God can look at sin. The world's sin has never overpowered God. In fact, that line is from the first line of Psalm 22, which says exactly, my God, why have you forsaken me? Which goes on to be a perfect prophecy of the cross, Psalm 22, written 1,000 years earlier. And it specifically says he has not hidden his face from the afflicted one. But at this moment, the darkness of Mark's gospel is coming to a conclusion. When some of those standing near heard, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. This fits Mark's theme. They never understand what Jesus is saying. It says, someone ran, filled with sponge and wine and vinegar, and put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. Which, by the way, fits right into Psalm 22. Mark is trying to make the connection very obvious. It says, now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down. It says, with a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. It's the roar of the lion. Yeah, I've never figured out the best way to coach or to communicate. But this was the Jesus that roars. And one of the gifts of having four different gospels is we don't always see this side of Jesus. The roar, the fast pace, the strength, the conflict, the cosmic battle, the scope. But at the very end of the darkness and the mystery of Mark, there's a roar from the lion. And he breathes his last. It's very interesting. It says the curtain of the temple was torn in two. In fact, we get our English word schism from the Greek word here. The law was broken and torn in half. And it says when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, surely this man was the Son of God. And this is really artful, literary-wise, because throughout the whole gospel, as I mentioned, the only people that say he's the Son of God is the divine voice from heaven or the cosmic demons crying out that he's the Holy One. And now not a Jewish person, but a Roman, who would have been very shocking for Mark writing in 43 to a group of people who were oppressed by Romans to say it was a Roman at the end of my gospel that finally figured out this guy was the Son of God. Now the ending of Mark. Now the ending, you need to know, I need to tell you the truth about it, and most of you probably know this. If you look at a note in your Bible, hopefully it'll tell you that Mark probably ended at verse 8 of chapter 16. There's a whole lot of verses after that, but they absolutely were not written by Mark. It doesn't mean they shouldn't be a part of the Bible. It doesn't mean they don't have value. But when we go back in textual criticism, they're not in any of the early manuscripts. I mean, none. They don't show up till late in these last verses. And so really, we have to understand clearly that Mark ended his gospel either intentionally or unintentionally or was lost at verse 8 of 16. And I want to read those last verses to you. This is what it says. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they might anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away, and they entered the tomb, and they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. And by the way, the details that John Mark gives, they do drip with authenticity. In fact, some of the only, I told you last week, 90% of Mark is contained in Matthew. The 10% that is uniquely Mark is almost all strange eyewitness details. He's the only one that remembered that when Jesus calmed the storm, he was asleep on a cushion at the front, which is a big deal because we feel like that about God a lot. He's the only one that has the most hilarious passage in all of Scripture when in the Garden of Gethsemane, some guy runs off naked for no reason whatsoever. It's the most random piece of all Scripture, but John Mark remembered it. Because he was theoretically there, heard it. In fact, there's one early church tradition that John Mark was the naked guy that runs off. But here he tells us on that day that those women told him that there was some strange guy who we have no idea who he was in white saying that Jesus isn't there. Don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He has risen. He isn't here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter, he's going on ahead of you into Galilee. There you'll see him, just as he told you. Isn't it interesting that he throws Peter separate from the disciples there? John Mark would, because it's Peter's stories. It's also important because Peter has, in a climax of the story, completely denied Jesus three times. Ironically, Mark's three times. Again, he's saying, make sure you tell Peter to go to Galilee. By the way, that's exactly what Jesus told him at the Last Supper. I'll go ahead of you to Galilee. He's built up in this dark, mysterious gospel that somehow he's going to rise and conquer this whole thing, and we're going to meet in Galilee. And here's the very last part of Mark. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. The end. Now, Mark's gospel was made to be read orally. I'm thankful that we don't only have Mark's gospel. I'm thankful for the lion's lens to look at Jesus and Mark's way of showing us the strength, the dynamite side of Jesus. I'm thankful that there's mystery in Jesus. Oh my gosh, I'm thankful that there's mystery in Jesus. In fact, one of the things that I want to say when we come to the big so what does this matter for us, is in some way, some of the darkness of Mark resonates with me more than any other gospel. The disciples are absolute failures. They never understand what Jesus is doing. It's very difficult. They abandon Jesus. They leave him. They come back. They're confused. And it all ends in fear. You go, well, that's dark. That's a great message. Well, guess what? That's a lot how life really is. There's a side of Mark that we can go, at least we're not the only ones. Following Jesus is not easy. It's hard. It's confusing. It's filled with mystery. Now, it's not an all dark ending. There's obviously ending with hope that the tomb is empty. And he's saying, go ahead to meet Jesus in Galilee. And you're almost left with this question. It's almost like if Mark's whole gospel came to a so what. The question the reader or the listener in the first century might have is, did they go? Did they go meet Jesus? Did they reconnect? Did they change the world? But what happened after that? And so one of the so what's for us is, are we going to do that? Remember when we talked about Rembrandt painting himself into the story? When we paint ourselves into the story of the Lion Gospel, and we have this very difficult, strong version of Jesus, which is one piece of the puzzle of understanding this complex, most incredible human of all time, we have to ask the question, are we all in on this? Are we going to go deeper? Are we going to go down the rabbit hole? There's the famous C.S. Lewis story from The Silver Chair. I'll confess I've never read The Silver Chair, but I've read this section of it many times, where Jill goes up to a river, and Aslan is there, the lion. She doesn't know that it's Aslan. She remembers, oh yeah, animals talk to her, because she hears this voice saying, hey, are you thirsty? You want to come get a drink at the river? And she's saying, well, yeah, I'm really thirsty. And he says, well, come on down. And she's like, yeah, you're a lion. This is a lot of paraphrasing, by the way. She says, well, you're a lion. He says, yeah. He says, well, are you thirsty? And she says, yeah. Well, she said, well, are you going to eat me? Are you safe? There's all these great questions. And he says, why? My favorite part is she says, do you eat little girls? And he says, I've eaten a lot of little girls and little boys and emperors and kings. He gives nothing to insinuate that he's a loving, warm lion. But he says, guess what? This is the only river. If you're thirsty, you're going to have to make a choice. Do you want to get involved with this wild, crazy, unpredictable lion, or do you want to die of thirst? She keeps taking steps closer, and then C.S. Lewis beautifully says when she drinks that water, she only has to have one sip because it satiates her. It's the water of life. This lion has the water of life. This lion is unpredictable and mysterious and at times dark, but ultimately hopeful, and I'm thankful for Mark's gospel. Now, here's what I want to do. I want to do something a little bit weird today. Maybe. We've never done anything like this before. We're going to come to communion to end our time. I hope that you're intrigued by Mark. I hope you take a challenge to go read it through this lens and re-see the way that the earliest gospel was written about Jesus. One that, by the way, calls him teacher about 100 times, but has the least teaching of anyone. It's almost all action. It's a lion. It's the fewest parables. It's just straight-up action of Jesus. But here's the thing. Mark also has one thing unique to his gospel. This is where I'm going to kind of turn it into something relevant today and to try to do something a little bit weird with our communion time today. He is writing to a community of people who are very persecuted for their beliefs in Christ. Now, we don't know if it was Nero's persecution or just the Roman persecution before the 70 destruction. We don't know when that time was, but the community who he first wrote difficultly in Greek to were people who were persecuted. In Mark 10:30, he's the only one that tells us that the disciples will be blessed 100 times more and they will receive persecution is a part of those blessings. Well, here's what I love about Mark. It may not have a lot of relevance for us today, but if you're in northern Iraq right now, you cracked open a copy of Mark. You read the Mark 13 about what things are going to look like for Christians, or you read only in Mark and nowhere else in the Gospels that part of the blessings of being a Christian is being persecuted. In northern Iraq, it would be as alive and living and active today as it was in the year 43 AD. We have to recognize that there are Christians around this world who are still living sometimes worse persecution than even those first Christians underwent. Yeah, Mark got dragged around and died, and almost all of them died a horrific martyr's death because they knew they saw the resurrected Jesus. It's even harder. In fact, 1 John tells us when John's an old man, he thought about us. He said, there's going to be a time for people who didn't get to see the resurrected Jesus, and how blessed are they when they have not the same evidence, and yet they still believe. The Gospel of Mark is relevant today in Iraq. It's relevant for Palestinian Christians. You know, there's World Vision kids right now in the Gaza Strip. There's parents in America who are getting letters, don't give to this Christian World Mission work because your kid got blown up last week. Christians all over the world are struggling. And I thought today we could try something different with communion. Communion is so many things. Communion is our union with God. As I often say, I hope if you've been here, you hear clearly how desperately and unconditionally loved you are. But we also say communion is a time of sharing a meal together. And today, an act of solidarity, because there are horrific things happening. There are 50,000 people hiding on a mountain right now from a very evil group of people that are cutting their heads off and sticking them on poles. This is graphic and real. There's mothers that are spitting into their children's mouth because they're dying of thirst. Think of Flagstaff, 50,000 people. If we all had to run because a group came in and said, we're going to cut your head off if you don't convert to our religion. And 50,000 of us are trying to live up on the saddle in Lockett Meadow with no food or anything. These are our brothers and sisters. And it's not just Christians. There's another religious group called the Yazidi who are also up there in the mountains. And we love them too. We don't want them to be persecuted or killed. And I often will criticize America, but I'm thankful today that America was the first country to dump 36,000 meals on this mountain to try to keep them alive. It makes me proud. There's things that America does that make me embarrassed, but I'm proud that we did that. And France immediately said, hey, we should do that too. And Britain said, we should do that too. And now they're parachuting meals to these starving children. But today, I thought we could, in our communion time, have an act of solidarity and pray for those people. I don't think praying for those people is going to change their situation. God made me that. That's God's choice. He's sovereign. And we go to him and we let him know, hey, we really want you to help out. And I hope that we do more than pray. I hope that you go research and figure out what things could you give your resources to, or your prayer time, or your strategies, or whatever gifts you have to help out these people. But at communion today, I want to challenge us to, in our communion time with our Lord. By the way, it's an optional time, it's an open time, and even this aspect is optional to you. I want to challenge you to have an act of solidarity as you talk to your Savior, the lion who shot the world and died for us, that we can be forgiven. When we commune with him today, can we think of those that don't have communion wine and bread, that can't celebrate Mass anymore? Invite them into that unity and solidarity in that time. Because I think that prayer matters. I think it matters for us. And I think it matters to them to know that they have a community all over this world that's praying for them and taking them. Now, it's also a time of reflection. It's also a time to talk to God about his great love and forgiveness. And we have four places here with wine or grape juice. It's optional, and it's open to everyone. Let me pray over this, and during that time, I want to challenge you to have that conversation with God. Let's do that together. God, thank you for your beloved son, John Mark. God, thanks if it's true. Thankful that he saw water turn to wine and that he saw his own life turn from ordinary to extraordinary. Thank you for his faithfulness. Thanks for his dark gospel that also is filled with hope. And God, we come to you today truly with heavy hearts. And we're so spoiled here, God. Forgive us for the times we take it for granted, God. We truly, dearly love our diverse family around this planet. God, we pray for those that are suffering today. As we come to your table, which means so much, Father, please, we're begging you to help them. God, make a way for them to have a meal. God, let them experience freedom. Let them know that we love them. Let them know right now that we're praying for them and with them. And God, move our hearts. Inspire us to do what we can in every way to help those children and those women and those men from every faith that are being evilly persecuted. God, I dream of a day, we dream of a day, we have hope as Christians. We're not some philosophy, God. We have so much hope that one day this is all going to be made right. That's part of the gospel of Mark. This is going to be redeemed. It's going to be fixed. But right now, we're on the wrong side of that. We don't understand great evil. We don't understand children suffering. We just want to let you know, please, God, help them. Thank you that they're forgiven. Thank you that their hope is in your great sacrifice. But God, we also ask that you bless them with your presence. God, also in this communion time, as always, individually, God, forgive us of our sins, please. That great evil that exists in the world also exists in my heart. And God, we thank you for Mark's gospel and all the others that give us the picture that our hope is that your righteousness supersedes our evil. It takes our place. Forgive us of our sins. We receive your unconditional love and we ask you to help us share that with the world. Well, I don't know if you guys know, but I felt like that was really dark, talking about Mark. Mark's a dark gospel, and it's sometimes hard to think about the evil that's in the world. This is kind of cool. I ran back around on my way, and I just picked up my phone, and I saw a little notification that, because it's about, I think it's about 14 hours ahead over there in the night, but the reports were Sunday are coming back, and about 20,000 of those 50,000 people have been rescued, and ISIS is being driven back, which is good. It's a start, but there's still 30,000 people up there, and I think the thing that I want us to think about a lot is, if you've been here a lot, you know, we don't get real heavy and dark often, but we are connected to these people. The body of Christ and humans in general, we're connected to each other. And one of the cool things about these Yazidi people, they're not Christians at all. We love them dearly. We want them to be rescued. And one of the cool parts of their story, it's one of the most ancient religions in the world, far older than Christianity, 6,700 years old. It's this monotheistic religion. And they have started to embrace Christianity as a part of their Zoroastrian religion. You want to know why? Because when the Ottoman Empire took over and there was Islamic extremists, and by the way, please don't hate Islamic people because of what their extremists are doing. That would be as logical as hating Christians because of Westboro Baptists. Please don't do that. But what extremist Islamics have done is said, we can forcefully make you convert to Islam or we will cut your head off. And right beside them, they saw Christians suffering. And they said, these guys have something to offer. And that's why to this day, the Yazidis are embracing Christianity, because they followed the way of the suffering lion. Because the kingdom of God was never supposed to be the Messiah that the people thought was a big power struggle, violent thing. It was always to follow Jesus on the difficult path of suffering. And I'm thankful for those that have lived that out in a context that we may never have the chance to do in our spoiled country, which I'm very thankful for. In fact, I'm embarrassed to say I'm maybe more thankful than ever for how safe my children are tonight. And I think we should be thankful as long as we're also loving in that same context. Here's the thing, there is great hope. We don't live in darkness as Christianity. We have great hope because although Mark's ending is vague, it gives us the hope of the resurrection. These other three portraits tell us the great news of what it means that God is alive. And we're going to look next week at Luke, the great physician, the doctor and historian, as he unfolds a clear apologetic of who Jesus is. And it's going to crescendo into our look at John when all the secrets are gone and the truth of God's incarnation and love for humanity is revealed. So I invite you to come back and be a part of that. It's exciting, I think, to look at these four irreplaceable texts that are such a gift to us that we have. A couple things tonight, just so you know, we're going to go out and be together if you want. You're all invited. We're going to go to some burrows tonight if you want to hang out on a patio or just be together. Please feel free. Everyone's welcome to that. We're also going to play soccer tonight on the South Fields if you want to be a part of that. Again, everyone is welcome. If you're new here, please, there's a welcome table. If you have any questions, we have some representatives from our community groups that can answer stuff for you, or you can grab a sticker or whatever you want. Let me pray for you guys and we'll take off. God, thanks for this family. God, honestly and candidly and selfishly, you know that I am a little extra thankful for our safety and freedom today. Thankful, God. And Lord, we do pray for those that don't have that. As we go and eat a meal right now, we're thankful to you, God. And we pray for those that don't have that. That make us the kind of people who are lovingly aware and thankful, that we'll be marked by our gratitude, we'll be marked by our following you into a life of suffering for you, love that the world can't help but notice. We love you and thank for your incomparable grace. In Jesus' name, amen.